Recorded Books presents The 13th Hour, Chaos, by Richard Deutsch. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. A quote from Albert Einstein. Time is an illusion. A quote from William Shakespeare. Better 3 hours too soon than a minute late. A quote from Dickie Deutsch. We're all so clockwise thinking we control our time, yet the sand slips through our fingers and muddles up our wine. Prologue. Somewhere between dreams and memories. Nick skimmed across the cool blue water, the kite board strapped to his feet, cutting deep into the Atlantic. He held tight to the bar as he glanced ahead at his neon green kite that caught the 30-knot wind and pulled him through the waves and into morning. With a flick of his wrist, Nick angled the kite straight up and launched into the air. 10 feet up, 20 feet, 30 feet. Still climbing. As he floated through the sky, he glanced down at the waves breaking on the shore before looking to the horizon, where the rising sun painted the day. The view, the sound of waves and wind and seagulls, and the briny tang of the sea enveloped him in an adrenaline-fueled serenity. Perfection of moment, he called it. When all his senses filled to overflowing, and every worry and concern fled from his mind. For the 6 seconds he flew, everything felt right in the world. No troubles, fears, or nightmares. What many considered an adrenaline addiction had become a salve for Nick's soul, the only escape that brought equilibrium to his mind. Given the stresses of work, family, and life, everyone needed relief. Some found it through golf, some through alcohol, some through other forms of entertainment. Ordinary exercise wasn't enough for Nick. He needed something slightly more intense. Since childhood, Nick had sought escapes that felt proportional to his troubles. Skydiving for work, speed skiing for life, and kitesurfing for nightmares. The faster he went, the better he felt. The higher he jumped, the farther he left his troubles behind. It had been 3 years. 3 years since Nick had saved his wife Julia from bullets, crooked cops, and the plane crash, all of which had never happened. Nick still had a tough time wrapping his mind around that. For 12 hours he had tried desperately to save Julia, to stop the world from falling apart, to find that singular moment that would undo disaster and set the planet back on its axis. Yet, in the end, after Nick had finally succeeded, in the minds of everyone but him, those events had never occurred. Saving Julia and the others would have been impossible, a task beyond even his imagination, if not for the watch that Seamus Hennicott had given him. The ancient gold and silver pocket watch had sent him on an impossible journey to undo the horrors of those 12 terrible hours. Seamus Hennicott, a 93-year-old billionaire, who still drove around in his rust-dotted 68 Buick Electra, was more than Nick's friend. More than Julia's law client and pseudo-grandfather. He was their savior. Only Seamus knew what Nick had gone through, and what had caused his trauma-induced nightmares after. Seamus knew not from memory, because to Seamus and the rest of the world, the tragedies of that day had never happened. Seamus knew because he was the only person Nick had dared explain it all to. the only one who would believe Nick because, after all, it was Seamus's pocket watch.
"Wake up."
The voice seemed to come from the far distance. Nick looked down at the open ocean but saw nothing. It was as if the voice came from one of his dreams, echoing impossibly in the open air. As he listened for the voice, he couldn't be sure whether it was yesterday, 3 years ago, or tomorrow. But one thing was clear. The voice was real, and it was calling to him.
"Wake up."
Author's note. You will not be mistaken when you hear me read chapter 12. The chapter numbers in this novel run in reverse order and are meant to be read that way for reasons that will become evident during your journey. Chapter 12. 5 p.m. The enormous wall climbed to heaven and stretched a quarter mile wide, like a barrier constructed to keep out the barbarian hordes. Made of 5-ton granite and concrete blocks, the dam loomed over the green valley, its growing shadow marking time like an oversized sundial. Nick stood on a balcony, staring up at the 410-foot-tall marvel of engineering, constructed in 1917 to hold back the billions of gallons of the Killian Reservoir. The blue sky and crisp, clean air of the summer day helped clear his mind and calm his nerves. He had slipped through a lower-level door onto the teak porch, hoping Julia wouldn't mind his momentary disappearance from helping prepare for the reception. The building that loomed behind Nick was as magnificent as the dam, and far more beautiful. The large castle looked like something plucked from the Middle Ages, though it had never housed a king, queen, or any other royalty. Built on a whim by the eccentric industrialist James Francis Dorchester, it had been donated to the town of Byram Hills when Dorchester left for Hawaii shortly after meeting the fourth future former Mrs. Dorchester. Constructed of granite, the English-style castle was adorned with corner towers, high keeps, parapets, decorative merlons, and scattered turrets, with half the structure carved into the steep, rocky hillside. While the walls and battlements were stone, the architects had softened its medieval appearance with several levels of ornamented teak porches that wrapped three sides, overlooking the carved marble statuary and ornate garden of perennials below. The interior gained warmth and character from cherry-paneled walls, thick Turkish rugs, and enormous windows that provided panoramic views of both the valley below and the adjacent dam. The warlike fortification, created out of nostalgia rather than for defense, had served as the designated fallout shelter for the local officials and their families during the 1950s and 60s. Its thick granite blocks, fused with a cement-like mortar, would not only withstand a 1960s-era Soviet bomb, but also outlast the pyramids of Giza. Nick smiled as he looked at the thousand-strong crowd gathering in the enormous grassy park 150 feet below, and wished he were down there instead of up here, dreading the next hour of his life.
"Wake up."
Julia gently stroked Nick's whiskered cheek as she kissed him awake.
"Wake up, my hero. Busy evening ahead."
Nick stirred, his mind rising to the surface as he sat up straight in his office chair, twisting his kinked neck, which had stiffened during his too short nap. his eyes locked with Julia's, the spouses each saying so much more than they could have with words. He smiled as the fog cleared and he took in his wife. Her blonde hair framed the face he had known since they were teenagers, her full lips smiling, her impish glee at waking him etched in her warm blue eyes. He loved when she kissed him awake. There was no better way to be pulled from a dream. He had slept for all of a half hour, having worked all day crunching numbers on a prospective real estate transaction, and finishing his first book here in his dark wood library office. This was after a minor incident with Marcus early this morning, which had upended his normal daybreak routine. He had picked up his best friend at 7:25 a.m., kites and boards loaded in the rear of the Jeep Wrangler, the jet ski hitched to the back in hopes of a couple of hours of kite surfing before work. But that all went to hell when Murphy's Law stepped in on the back of fate, ending his chance of getting anywhere near the water that morning. "How's it feel to be a hero?" Julia asked playfully. "Not a hero," Nick groaned, clearing his sleepy voice. "They're saying you and Marcus didn't want your names mentioned." "It's not like we did it for recognition."
"Surely you can at least share the details with your wife?"
"Well, the flames, tell me later. It's already after 3. We've got to be at the castle by 4. Julia leaned in and kissed him again. "We both know you're incapable of telling a short story."
4? Guests aren't supposed to arrive until 5:15.
"We're the hosts, remember? It's better to be early and prepared than
late and screwed." Nick finished her sentence for the 1,000th time as an incessant ticking tickled his ears. "Where are you going?"
"I have to run some errands."
Julia blew him a kiss and left his office before shouting back at him,
"Do me a favor and take out the garbage."
"Of course," Nick called back.
"I'll be back at 3:45. Be ready. Don't make us late."
The ticking seemed to grow an echo as Julia exited through the foyer.
"I'm going to smash this thing,"
Julia shouted as she walked out the front door. Nick already regretted having bought the mahogany Man-O-War-themed grandfather clock 2 days ago. It had been a foolish purchase, like fireworks to a soldier suffering PTSD. The clock's ticking reminded Nick of what he had tried so hard to forget. To make matters worse, the beautiful antique wasn't only rattling his brain, it was also rattling his marriage. Every hour, starting with a heavy mechanical click, the giant clock would ring out a brief, seafaring tune on its internal brass bells before intoning the hour with a rhythmic chime. The chiming had lasted all of one night. Julia said it was worse than torture. Not only the annoying clicks, but also the loud peal of the bell, which risked waking Katie every hour on the hour. It took Nick 45 minutes to figure out how to disable the bells, but the ticking of the brass pendulum continued. He had already listed the clock for sale online, and promised Julia he'd move it out to the garage by nightfall. It was 3:41 when Nick heard Julia's car roll into the driveway. He jumped up from his desk, raced upstairs, hit the bathroom, shaved, made himself presentable, and headed for his closet. Though he knew it would make her mad, he slipped on a pair of Levi's, a polo shirt, and his 22-year-old cowboy boots. He also grabbed a pair of charcoal gray Armani pants, a button-down shirt, a tie, and a sport coat, slipped them all on a hanger, grabbed a pair of dress shoes, and prepared to face Julia's wrath.
"You've got to be kidding me," she said, as Nick hung the hanger in the back of her blue Audi, then climbed into the driver's seat.
She eyed him up and down.
"You had to wear the jeans. You're not going to have time to change."
Nick would have plenty of time to change, more than an hour, though he had no intention of arguing with her.
"Hi, Daddy,"
Katie said from her car seat in the back.
"Hey, honey."
Nick turned and smiled at his daughter.
"Don't you look like a princess?"
And she did. With white blonde hair, giant blue eyes that matched her party dress, and a broad, giggly smile, she could warm the heart of winter.
"Say hi to Abigail,"
Katie held out a stuffed giraffe.
"Hello, Abigail. She keeps the bad people out of my dreams."
"Well, that's a good giraffe," Nick told the toy as he kissed its head.
"Thank you for protecting my little girl's dreams."
He handed it back. "Hi, Bonnie," he said to the teenager sitting next to Katie as he started the car and pulled out of their driveway.
"Hi, Mr. Quinn."
Bonnie Powers twirled her long brown hair around her index finger, the way 15-year-olds do when they're shy and can't figure out what to do with their hands. Still, the teenage babysitter would keep 3-year-old Katie entertained and occupied during the reception.
"Thanks for coming," he told Bonnie. "Mommy said you're her hero," Katie whispered, struggling with the word hero.
"Well," Nick laughed, "I guess I am." He didn't turn to look at Julia, who clearly wasn't sharing his mirth.
"Do you remember to take out the garbage?" she asked without looking at him.
Nick knew that she knew he hadn't. Her question wasn't so much about the garbage as it was to point out that he'd forgotten to do what he'd promised. Again. 3 years earlier, Julia had asked Nick to take out the garbage as per their custom, and then she'd taken it out 5 minutes later when he hadn't, also per their custom. It was out in the driveway, on her way back from emptying the garbage, that Julia's water had broken. Nick had rushed her to Greenwich Hospital, but what they thought would be an easy labor process turned into a 36-hour ordeal. Slow to dilate, slow to efface. They grew frustrated, but it was when Julia finally began to push that Nick became scared. Without a drop of medication, without ever considering an epidural, Julia pushed as hard as she could to get that baby out, her face beet red, her temples throbbing, her eyes swelling unnaturally. As Katie finally emerged, healthy and screaming, Nick turned to his wife, beaming with pride, only to find her unconscious.
"Julia," he'd said softly,
knowing how exhausted she must be.
"I'm so proud of you."
But Julia hadn't responded.
"Julia?"
Nick rubbed her forehead.
"Julia?"
And everything had slipped to hell. Dr. Culverhart and the nurses rushed Nick out of the room as an oxygen mask was dropped over Julia's face. Nick could see through the circular door window as they desperately worked on her, mouth to mouth, pumping her chest, jabbing a needle in her arm. Dr. Culverhart's voice turned grave as he ordered the nurses about. Nick thought he was going to lose her, certain she would die without ever getting to hold their daughter. But finally, she'd opened her eyes with a gasp, looking around, confused at the commotion. Through the window, he saw her mouth form the word, "Nick?" He burst through the door and raced to her side, bending to take her in his arms, holding her as tightly as he dared.
I thought I lost you, he said through his tears.
In his ear, Julia had whispered, I'll never leave you, silly.
Standing on the balcony of Byram Castle, Nick stared down into the valley at nearly 1,000 people playing baseball, picnicking, and getting early seats on the enormous grassy mall for the best fireworks show in Westchester County. Festivities, from parades to awards ceremonies to school band performances, had filled the afternoon and would continue into the night. All in celebration of the 4th of July. Nick looked at his iPhone to check the time. 5:05. Like so many, he had disposed of his wristwatch in favor of the multifunction device that was the modern-day equivalent of his Swiss Army knife. He had wandered about the castle for almost an hour after arriving, thinking it best to stay out of Julia's way, and busying himself with phone calls, emails, and the internet. The upper reaches of the fortress held modernized conference rooms and offices, while the bowels of the stone castle seemed to exist a century or two in the past, mimicking a European stronghold in every sense. Nick had never been in a dungeon, but was pretty sure the castle's sub-basement came close. It felt like the center of the earth there, the depths of a man-made cave cold and damp, the echo of life above blotted out. He explored the lower recesses like a curious child, finding a host of rooms straight out of the past, each concealed behind doors of 4-inch-wide planks strapped with thick iron bands, their heavy clasps rusted with age, all unlocked, empty, and forgotten. Tired of the dank and dark and the lack of cell reception, he moved back to the balcony and spent the last hour dialing, negotiating, and checking the live feed of the Yankees game. As he watched the crowds below, Nick couldn't help but feel a bit of envy. He was stuck up here about to endure something only a notch or two more pleasant than a root canal. He wasn't one for glad-handing and false smiles. He had a revulsion for politics and its facades, and detested writing checks to the political elite, all of which he had done over the years in deference to Julia's work world. Today, his wife's law firm, Akins, Isles & Lerner, was sponsoring the meet-and-greet with Byron Chase, the senior U.S. Senator from New York, who was not only the head of the Senate Intelligence Committee, but he also sat on Appropriations, the committee that held the all-important purse strings of federal funding. One of the sources of the lifeblood that made the consulting arm of Julia's firm viable. Unlike most politicians, Byron Chase was a friend. Hailing from Byram Hills, he embodied the hometown boy made good, a politician who many believed actually possessed integrity and honesty. He had taught at Byram Hills High School 20 years earlier and served as Nick and Julia's swim coach. Despite not knowing any stroke beyond basic freestyle, Coach Chase had spent half his time yelling at Nick about how to swim better when Nick already held every school record, was all county, and had been the team captain 2 years running. Chase had spent the other half of his time telling Julia she could do so much better than staying with young Mr. Quinn. Chase had left teaching after getting his law degree at night, and quickly found himself at Akins, Isles, and Lerner, before becoming a state representative. Soon after, he became a U.S. congressman, and then he set his sights even higher. He had been elected to the U.S. Senate on a platform of integrity and change, with a large dose of voter sympathy over the loss of his son in the Uzbekistan War. Sadly, not much had changed since his election to the Senate. Only the same politically correct stances abstained votes on controversial bills, and the hollow rhetoric of his predecessor. At $1,000 per handshake and $2,500 per photo op, Nick figured his former swim coach would be leaving the meet-and-greet with a take of more than $400,000, two tea sandwiches, and four martinis. Nick wasn't sure if he still held a real grudge against Chase for trying to push Julia away from him when they were teenagers, or if he was being stubbornly childish due to his dislike of politics. Nick turned and saw a Secret Service agent sweeping the castle grounds. News vans from the local stations parked in front with their reporters, hoping they could wangle a soundbite or interview with the man who many said was the apparent heir to the throne of the presidency. Well, Nick hadn't voted for Chase before and wasn't about to change that now. Another glance at his iPhone told him that he'd lost all track of time, forgetting to change out of his jeans and into his jacket and tie. He left the balcony, rounded the corner into the reception room, and ran headlong into Julia. It took a moment for her to digest the moment before she gave Nick the look. Her expression telling him, "I can't believe you, not again." Julia being Julia, however, she never verbalized it. Not once in their nearly 19 years together. Although it was a phrase she could have easily uttered multiple times per week. Nick stared back at her for a moment, not minding her anger. She wore an off-white linen dress, her hair brushed out, and looked like a model who had stepped off the catwalk. Her appearance was elegant and refined, projecting her professionalism while sprinkling it with a touch of glamour. She wore the simple gold necklace with a diamond at its center, and the matching earrings that he had given her last Christmas. On her wrist was her mother's gold Rolex. Though never in need of makeup, she wore a touch of lipstick and eyeliner, which accentuated her beauty. At 36 years of age, Julia looked 10 years younger. Her skin flawless, her eyes filled with life and projecting her unending energy. It always amazed Nick that she could work out, grocery shop, get her nails done, and feed Katie, all before he even brushed his teeth in the morning. She would race into the bedroom in tight-fitting shorts and a t-shirt, her blonde hair pulled back in a ponytail, head straight for her bathroom and closet, and within minutes emerge sophisticated, alluring, and ready to take down the business world. "What's going on?" he asked innocently. "Seriously? Beyond the fact that people are due to arrive in 10 minutes and you're not dressed? Or the fact you disappeared for the last hour? All eyes are on us today. The senator, his speech, this party, the news media, all on top of a crazy day of unfinished work and missed meetings." She moved back into the reception room, rearranging flowers, moving chairs inches to the left or right, and ensuring that every wine bottle's label on the bar faced out. "It's Coach Chase," Nick said. "That's right, Senator Chase. Senator Byram Chase." "Byron, he's no Byron. His name's Carl. Carl Byram Chase. Since when did he drop Carl from his name? That was 20 years ago, Nick." "Yeah, well, he's the same man. He just wears a fancy suit and sits in a bigger office that doesn't smell like sweat and Ben Gay." "He's still a senator." "He's still an ass." Nick regretted his words before they hit Julia's ears. "Can you just let it go?" She turned and moved closer to Nick. "For me, this all reflects on me today. Do you understand that?" He nodded. "Sorry, I'll shut my mouth." Julia turned to adjust the podium, opening the curtains 2 inches more.
It's an awful lot of security and hoopla for a senator, Nick said softly.
Nick, I'm just saying.
There are some crazy people out there, even some death threats, and Chase may announce he's throwing his hat in the presidential election ring.
Ha, Nick said with a laugh.
That explains the reporters. With his approach to... At Julia's glare, he shut his mouth again.
Sorry, what can I do to help?
Just... Julia bit her lip. Go get changed, hurry back to greet people when they arrive, and use that faux happy-to-see-you smile you've got in your back pocket to pretend you're enjoying yourself.
Nick walked through the entrance lobby and down a long, sconced line hall to the bathrooms, only to find a Secret Service agent there. He headed back to the conference room, finding another agent on his phone, and opted instead to head back down into the dungeon. He found the kitchen, where caterers were busy filling trays with cheese puffs, stuffed mushrooms, and shrimp skewers. Nick smiled a guilty smile at a young hostess as he grabbed a handful of mini hot dogs and continued down into the dark recesses of the basement. Once again, he found rooms within rooms, a forever maze that wound about the castle's foundation and deep into the cliffside. Finally, Nick stopped in an especially bare stone chamber. He figured here was as good a place as any to change. He quickly slipped into his dark slacks and Armani jacket, stuffed his other clothes in a bag, and found a door out onto a lower balcony.
When you escape hell, you're supposed to bring your friends with you.
Nick turned as an oversized hand fell upon his shoulder.
Right, Katie? The voice continued.
Daddy!
Katie rode upon the shoulders of an enormous bear of a man.
Hey, kiddo, Nick said. Did Uncle Marcus bring you down here, or did you bring him?
Marcus reached up and lowered Katie to the balcony, her tiny hand holding tight to his finger.
4th of July, cocktail hour. Where else would I rather be than hearing a politician roar about his conquests of the jungles of D.C.?
You know that the only one more upset about this than you is me, right?
Nick said, then added.
Thanks for coming.
Marcus Bennett stood 6'1", with 230 pounds of muscle, his bald, gleaming head shining in the late day sun. Marcus was Nick's best friend, next door neighbor and partner in all things. Hockey, kite surfing, poker, and other brands of minor mischief.
You'd think we'd get a pass after all we did this morning, said Marcus,
as Katie pulled him toward the railing that looked over the valley. As Katie's godfather, Marcus had gone from being a rough-and-tumble ex-military businessman who couldn't keep his fists in his pockets to a childlike uncle who didn't hesitate to roll on the floor and play with dolls. Katie was the David to his Goliath, slaying him with a smile, bending him to her will like no business adversary or bar fight opponent ever could. Nick marveled at the constant changes in Katie. Her weekly growth, the teeth that seemed to suddenly fill her mouth, her ever-expanding vocabulary. She had a tender innocence to her voice, a Cindy Lou Who quality magnified by the words of toddlerhood. Finder for finger, vanilla for vanilla, peas for please. He loved her mispronounced vocabulary and never corrected her, hoping she'd hold on to her innocence forever. He had never imagined the emotional depths of fatherhood, the joy, the worry, and how his heart burst with warmth every time he heard her voice. When he'd first learned Julia was pregnant, he was secretly fearful. How would their lives change? What would come of their mornings lying in each other's arms, their lazy Sundays of breakfast and newspapers in bed? Would it all be lost and forgotten? But as with most parents, what they gave up was replaced with something far more precious. Nick could no longer imagine life without Katie, without her laughter or tears, as she explored and came to know her world. The swooshing sound of her legs against her diapers as she raced down the hallways of their home. The uncontrollable giggles and laughter when Theo, their six-month-old Bernese Mountain Dog puppy, licked her ears, or their simple game of peekaboo. While raising Katie, Nick had rediscovered the wonders of childhood. The magic of Christmas, the spooky fun of trick-or-treat, manic Easter egg hunts, and blowing out birthday candles. Life's priorities had come into sharp focus, and his had taken on a new sense of purpose and fulfillment. Like most couples with a new child, Nick and Julia had experienced a paradigm shift with their friends, many falling away, those without children still spending Friday and Saturday nights out for dinner, movies, and dancing. Only their closest friends modified their lives to spend time with the happy trio, content to come over for takeout and share in Nick and Julia's parental joy. "Where's Dreyfus?" Marcus asked Nick. "How did he get out of this?" "I have no idea," Nick said, "but I'm sure he'll make it. He's never late for anything." And he wasn't. Punctual was an understatement. You could set your watch by Paul Dreyfus's adherence to schedule. A security expert for Fortune 500 companies, as well as Seamus Hennicott and his wealthy associates, Paul Dreyfus was eminently successful, highly responsible, and always timely. He was also the third stooge in Marcus and Nick's sandbox. He kept their reindeer games this side of legal, ensured their wounds were properly dressed, and served as a stand-in godfather to Katie whenever Marcus regressed into childhood. "By the way," Marcus said, "Julia's looking for you."
"Mommy's looking for you," Katie echoed. "I think she's mad."
"Why do you think that, honey?"
"'Cause she said, go find father,
instead of daddy," Katie giggled.
Nick looked to Marcus. "And you volunteered to leave the fun and find me?" Marcus smiled and shrugged. "That's what friends do." Nick and Julia stood at the large wooden entrance doors to Byram Castle, shaking hands, nodding, and endlessly engaging in questions of children, health, and the weather, while also wishing everyone a happy 4th of July. Among the guests was Marcus and his latest wife, Anissa. Martin Renab, another of Nick's kitesurfing buddies, and his wife, Yolanda, their forever friends, Kirsten and Rocco, John Bay, the rhythm guitarist from Nick's band, Michael Ponce, his skydiving compadre, the Close, who actually enjoyed the politics of it all, the Mortimers, who would do anything for Julia, Donna Schreier, Julia's close friend from the hospital, Sarah Bitten, Katie's daycare teacher, and the Fitzgibbonses, the star-struck sort of people who jumped at a chance to meet their senator. The castle now contained practically everyone on Nick and Julia Quinn's Christmas party invitation list. At least 40 couples, supplemented by partners from Julia's law firm, town officials, and political groupies. The only people not in attendance were the smart ones, the 1,000-plus who filled the grassy mall and sports fields below the dam, enjoying their 4th of July in the traditional way, with picnics and games while awaiting the evening's fireworks show. Hors d'oeuvres and drinks were passed by college-aged interns of the senator as people broke into cliques of conversational comfort. Nick hated to admit it, but he was enjoying himself. As he looked around, he realized that these were the people he actually liked to be with, the people he cared about, who made him laugh, think, and smile. "Where's Seamus?" Nick asked Julia in a quiet moment. "I couldn't reach him all day." "That's not like him." "Well, he is 93, she said. "And he would never miss one of your parties, even if he had one foot in the grave." "That's not right," she scolded. Hailing from ancient English heritage, Seamus was the wealthiest 93-year-old in the world. Not that it mattered to Nick and Julia. To them, he was more than a friend or client. He was like a father or grandfather. Stern but loving, filled with wisdom, but never pushy with it. Seamus and his wife Catherine had no children and no other family. So they looked to each other to fill that void and chose their family with care.
"I didn't mean it that way."
Nick rubbed her arm.
"I meant to go by his house, but work had me so tied up."
"We'll swing by his house on the way home. I'm sure he's fine." At 5:37, 22 minutes late, the large entrance doors opened, and the two Secret Service agents walked in, followed immediately by a tall Byron Chase, who smiled as he headed directly to Julia.
"I can't thank you enough for arranging all of this," Senator Chase said, looking properly regal in his dark blue power suit and red striped tie.
"It's our pleasure, Senator."
Julia gave him a small hug. "Julia," he chided her gently, "formalities were for high school. Call me Byron." He turned to Nick and thrust out his hand.
"Coach Carl,"
Nick said, immediately feeling Julia's eye bore into him. He took the senator's hand and smiled the smile that Julia had asked him to pull from his back pocket.
"Julia said you just wrapped up two large real estate acquisitions and finished your first book.
She's always bragging about me."
"Good for you," Chase said. "You were the only high school couple that I knew would get married and stay that way."
"Thank you."
Nick held his false smile. "I'm hoping she keeps me for a few more years."
"If you'll excuse me," Chase said. "I just need to review my notes with one of my aides."
Chase's focus had shifted even before he finished his sentence. Now he moved with a young assistant to a far corner.
"Coach Carl?"
Julia glared at Nick.
"Really?"
Nick gave his wife the same smile that she'd requested as she turned away and marched into the reception room.
"This was supposed to be my moment," Senator Chase said through gritted teeth. "He was supposed to be here to introduce me."
"Things happen," the young aide said. "I'll introduce you."
"No offense, but you lack even the appearance of someone important. After all this effort I've gone through to help him, he screws me yet again. I want to know the real reason why he blew me off."
"I don't know if I can."
"Just do it or find a replacement who can."
"Ladies and gentlemen," Julia said from the podium, the crowd reacting by dropping their conversations to a murmur,
"please welcome Senator Byram Chase."
Chase climbed the 18-inch platform and stood at the podium, nodding to the applauding crowd, pointing at strangers as if they were friends. He was an imposing man, fit, with dark gray-flecked hair, a disarming smile, and steely blue eyes. He rested his hands upon the sides of the red, white, and blue podium and cleared his throat.
"Before we get started," he said, raising his hands to quiet the room, "it's my great honor to announce something that has not even hit the press yet.
President Matthew McManus 2 hours ago, after a series of top-secret negotiations, signed not only a ceasefire, but a far-reaching peace accord with Uzbekistan and Russia, resolving long-standing economic issues. As the head of the Senate Intelligence Committee, I am proud to have been involved with this process, and I applaud our Commander-in-Chief on a difficult job well done. The war in Uzbekistan is over. The room erupted in genuine applause. The 4-year war had dominated the press, water cooler talk, and prayers of most Americans who feared an escalation into World War III. Which is a perfect segue into why I am here today, Chase continued. Peace through strength, prosperity through charity. It's time to step back from war and focus on peace and prosperity for all Americans, while never letting our guard down against terrorism again. Nick pulled out and glanced at his phone. 5:53. The 2-minute political oration already felt like an hour. Julia turned toward him with a painted-on smile and gave him the look. He quickly tucked his phone away. Katie charged through the room, her blonde hair floating behind her, and latched onto Nick's leg, pulling him toward the door as if he were being saved from hell by an angel. Nick picked her up and carried her to the lobby, out through the enormous heavy glass doors, closing them carefully behind them, cutting off the droning speech in favor of far more important words.
"I want to go outside and play," Katie said.
"Honey," Julia said, following them into the lobby with Bonnie the babysitter at her side. She took Katie out of Nick's arms. "I need you to stay with Bonnie for 15 minutes.
Why don't I take her outside?" Nick offered.
"We need to be in there," Julia said with a forced smile. "We're the hosts."
"But Katie wants to play."
A side door opened, and a man stumbled through, looking barely coherent, and fell into Nick's arms. His clothes were wet, his salt and pepper hair damp. Shocked, Nick realized he knew the man and knew him well. It was his close friend, Paul Dreyfus, who had been at the top of the guest list and uncharacteristically late. Nick supported his friend's sagging weight and led him to a large couch on the far side of the lobby, where Dreyfus collapsed heavily.
"Are you okay?" Nick asked Paul.
"What the hell happened?"
"Listen to me," Dreyfus whispered.
As Nick let go of his friend, he saw blood covering his hands. Quickly, Nick ripped open Dreyfus's shirt, revealing what looked like a bullet wound to the chest.
"Oh my God," Nick breathed. "Julia?"
Julia was immediately at his side.
"Bonnie," Julia turned to the babysitter, "could you take Katie to the bathroom in the back?"
Bonnie averted her eyes as she pulled Katie down through the back hall.
"What happened?" Nick asked his friend again.
Dreyfus pulled the strap of a dark leather satchel from about his neck and shoulder and looped it over Nick's.
"Listen to me, Nick. Listen very carefully."
Dreyfus paused to breathe, struggling to get the words out.
"Don't let that bag out of your sight. He's coming for you. He's coming for Julia."
"Who? What are you talking about?"
Dreyfus reached into the bag and withdrew a single picture that made Nick's blood run cold. It was an image of a man floating against the rocky shoreline of a lake, water lapping at his body, his face having lost all color, the skin white and curdled like rotted cheese, lips blue, cracked and wet. There was no question that the man had died a painful death.
In fact, he had almost surely drowned, his wet body and vacant stare leaving little doubt about the means of his demise. Nick tried to catch his panicked breath. He knew the man, knew him well, better than anyone. He was looking into his own lifeless eyes.
"You all die," Dreyfus whispered.
Julia turned to Nick, her skin flushing red as confusion filled her eyes.
"Nick?"
Her voice trembled. Nick stared at Dreyfus, the impossibility of his words echoing in his head.
"You, Julia?"
Dreyfus struggled to draw another breath.
"Katie? Everyone?"
Nick turned and looked through the glass doors at the gathered crowd, which listened in rapt attention to the senator's speech. Everyone Nick cared about was here, most listening to political rhetoric they couldn't care less about. They were all attending as a favor to Nick and Julia.
"When?"
Nick whispered to his dying friend. Dreyfus seized Nick's hand, locking eyes with him.
"It's all in the bag."
"What's in the bag?"
"You have to find me."
Dreyfus's words sounded like a plea.
"I don't understand. Find you where?" "I'm so sorry."
A sudden roar exploded from the room. Cheers and applause. As if the senator had concluded the speech of his life. The rising voices of the now standing audience only amplified Nick's dread. And then a rumble shook the world, deep and foreboding. Another rumble, an explosion, like a bomb, and then another, and another, and another. The crowd fell silent, eyes darting about in confusion. New York was not the land of earthquakes, but the shaking earth said otherwise. Deep, heavy rumblings seemed to roll the flagstone floor.
"Nick?"
Julia looked around the lobby in fear as a hum began to grow.
"What the hell is that?"
As the rumble grew in intensity, a collective panic took over the reception room. Chaos filling the air as everyone tried to flee from the unknown with incoherent screams of fear, cramming through the doors to escape whatever danger was approaching. The deep roar grew deafening, drowning out the screams, shaking the castle's foundations. And then, as if hell had been unleashed, the reception room's outer windows shattered, incomprehensibly. A wall of water drove through the space, rising toward the ceiling in seconds. Like a tidal wave, the barrage of water tore the room apart. Tables, chairs, fixtures, and carpets spun into a churning maelstrom. Men and women were scooped up, helplessly tossed about, bodies hurled and twisted into dark whirlpools. The light of day dimmed as the wall sconces winked out. Emergency lights reacted to the loss of power, their bright halogen rays flicking on, impervious to the water's assault within their clear plastic housings, their beams like shafts of lightning, piercing the murky, rising, roiling waters. An enormous howl of wind groaned as air was driven from the building, its gusts sweeping the water's surface into blinding mist. Husbands and wives, friends and neighbors were quickly swept away, their screams doused as they were pulled under and sucked out through the narrow window openings like water through a drain. From behind the thick glass doors, Nick and Julia watched in horror as their friends drowned, their twisted bodies becoming human flotsam and jetsam before being sucked out through the shattered picture windows on a violent tide into oblivion. The lobby had already become a deep pool, the waters rising to Nick and Julia's shoulders. Then, as if a tornado had struck, the glass doors were torn from their moorings and thrown into the tidal flow. A rush of water quickly rose toward the ceiling, sweeping Dreyfus's body away. Water filled the vestibule, its polished granite walls momentarily looking like an Italian pool. The coach where Dreyfus had lain, the tables and chairs, splintered in the onslaught, all flushed through the main doors, carried on a raging current.
"Katie!"
Julia screamed. In the rising water, Nick swam for the bathroom where Katie and Bonnie had gone, the leather satchel looped about his body, complicating the impossible task. The bathroom was at the far end of the vestibule, sequestered in a corner where the water's attack had been delayed by the turns of the hallway. But the small high windows now exploded, water pouring through as if from the spigots of heaven. Julia swam hard in the same direction, battling the raging waters that rose higher and higher. She fought with all her might, kicking and pulling against the current. But the suction created by the millions of gallons of flowing water took hold of her. Despite all her years of swimming, in spite of her natural strength, she was losing, drawn inch by inch toward the door where death awaited. Nick caught hold of her hand, his other arm wrapped tightly around a chandelier overhead. They were pulled and tossed by the water as it rose, pushing them up against the ceiling. Holding on with all his strength, Nick pulled her to him. But the suction made her feel like a 2-ton weight, straining his arms, his grip.
"Hold on!"
Nick yelled as their heads banged the ceiling, the water continuing to rise around them.
"We have to get Katie!"
Julia struggled to hold on as Nick fought with every fiber of his being to not let her slip away.
"Mommy!"
Katie's cry pierced the cacophony of churning waters.
"Katie!"
Julia screamed back.
"Mommy's coming!"
As the water pulled at them, Nick and Julia's eyes locked in an unspoken understanding of what was happening. In order to get to Katie, to have any hope of saving her.
"Let me go," Julia pleaded. "Save Katie. Please, please save Katie."
Nick looked deep into his wife's eyes. He couldn't bear to do what she was asking. She was everything to him, his life, his heart. She was his soul. "No," Nick said. "Hold on."
"It's okay,"
she said, holding his gaze.
"Let me go."
With her free hand, she grasped Nick's fingers and gently pried them loose. And with their eyes still locked, she released Nick's hand. Her body, caught in the suction, instantly disappeared. Despite the agony in his heart, Nick turned his body toward the bathroom. He reached and caught hold of one of the brass wall sconces mounted on the granite wall as the water continued its rise, only an inch of breathable air remaining. Nick plunged under into the current. The brass sconces lined the wall leading to the bathroom like a horizontal ladder. Hand over hand, he pulled himself along, fighting with all his might, his arms burning with the impossible effort. He briefly surfaced.
"Katie!"
he screamed in the narrow airway as he gulped sweet oxygen.
"I'm coming!"
But the force of the current, the draw of the millions of gallons of water flowing through the building, had grown tenfold. Sapped of strength, Nick dug deep within himself. He couldn't let her die. He wouldn't fail her.
"Please, Daddy,"
Katie cried from up ahead.
"Please."
As the rising water squeezed away the last bit of air, Nick took a deep breath and dived under again. He spotted the door, its giant brass handle gleaming with the refracted beams of the emergency lights. The thick mahogany portal opened outward, seated against a heavy metal frame, its design still withstanding the building pressure of the rising waters. But Nick knew it wouldn't hold for long. The waters were surely pouring under the door, through any and every crack as it sought the path of least resistance.
Daddy!
Even under the churning water, Nick could hear Katie's cry. The violence of the current grew unbeatable. The weight of the satchel around his neck, like a bag of lead. His lungs burning, fighting the rush of water that pulled at him, like a colossal magnet. Nick reached for the handle of the door, his fingertips swiping the brass. Straining for purchase, he planted his legs against the wall and used his last bit of strength to grasp the door. The fire in his lungs pushed him to the brink, twinkling spots dancing before his eyes as his brain thirsted for oxygen. And the suction caught hold of him, yanking him away, pulling him backwards toward the shattered windows. With utter despair, his heart broken, having failed his wife and daughter, Nick knew he would join them in death. Unable to resist, he gasped, and the water invaded his lungs. And his world fell to darkness. Chapter 11. 4 p.m. Nick's eyes flicked open, his head a tumble of confusion. A metallic, blood-like taste filled his mouth as a bitter chill coursed through him. He looked away from his prone position, realizing he was soaked to the bone, drenched, the water puddling from his clothes upon the stone floor of a darkened room. Battered, bruised, and sore, he could barely move as he looked around the windowless space, a dim light seeping through an open door 20 feet away, a murmur of voices in the distance, momentarily obscured by a rustling of heavy, moving objects. Nick sat up, struggling to regain his senses and strength as he peered into the shadows. As his mind sharpened, his focus returning, Nick tried to remember the day. Arriving at the castle at 3:55, wandering the various levels of the old building while making a series of calls, some necessary, some not, most conducted as a matter of avoidance, a means of escaping preparations for the reception in honor of Senator Byron Chase. Finally, Nick stood, his strength returning as the cobwebs swept from his memory. A sharp pain exploded in his heart. Everything he cared about, everyone he loved, was gone. Julia was dead, drowned, swept away on a raging torrent as the castle filled with water. Katie, helpless and all of 3 years old, trapped within a flooded bathroom. Her father unable to save her or her babysitter. Nick tried to remain on his feet, but despair crushed him, sending him back to the stone floor, waves of nausea consuming him as his body coiled into a fetal position. The guilt hurt worse than any pain he'd felt before. Guilt for failing to protect Katie, for waiting too long to honor Julia's final sacrificial plea to save their daughter. He couldn't make sense of what had happened. He'd never even considered it during the chaos and struggle. But he could only think of one explanation. The enormous Killian Dam had broken, unleashing a torrent into the castle and wiping out every life but his own. He cursed his fortune of survival, a cruel twist of fate that was already testing his sanity. For being left without those he loved left him little reason to live. And what of the others who lay in the wake of the dam break? The thousands gathered to celebrate the holiday, playing ball, picnicking, laughing? Families? Children? As Nick wondered at the magnitude of it all, questioning how he'd escaped with his life, he felt the satchel strap about his neck. Paul Dreyfus's satchel. "Don't let that bag out of your sight," his friend had pleaded before dying. Nick removed it from his aching body, laying it on the dimly lit floor. He realized its leather exterior was, in fact, a facade. He lifted the flap to find a heavy zipper and quickly undid it. There was no question as to the bag's design or purpose. It was waterproof. A dive sack, the kind used for scuba diving, constructed with a neoprene interior, watertight, including the zipper seal. Peering in, unable to see its contents in the shadowed room, Nick dug his hand in and pulled out a video camera, a cell phone, a car key, and two envelopes. He could barely read the writing on the first envelope in the room's lack of light, but he could see that it was addressed to him. He tore it open and quickly read the letter as his eyes adjusted to the dimness. "Nick, there's still time. To save Julia, to save us all. I don't have much time, which seems ironic. I have been..." Nick swiftly finished reading the letter and jammed his hand back into the satchel. His fingers scrambled about until his hand fell upon an object. He didn't need to see it to recognize it, to envision the cold disc of metal. Round, small, compact, fitting perfectly in the palm of his hand. A mix of dread and of hope suffused Nick as he pulled out the ancient pocket watch. He pressed the familiar crown, popping open the cover and checking the time. Despite the screaming of his logical mind, his eyes didn't lie. The hands of the antique watch read 4:04. Nick leapt to his feet, suddenly understanding. He tucked the watch in his wet pocket, stuffed everything else back in the satchel, zipped it up, and slung it over his shoulder and neck. He ran through the open door into the stone hallway, down the corridor, and tore open a dark wooden door, racing through and bursting out into the light of day, the sudden brightness assaulting his eyes. He stood upon a teak terrace at the foot of Byram Castle, looking down upon the valley below. It was green, lush, the fields filled with families, bikers, softball teams, children on swings, teens playing frisbee. 1,000 people all enjoying the warm 4th of July sun under a blue sky. Nick turned and looked up the valley to the north. The enormous dam stood there in all its glory, casting a magnificent shadow. It appeared sound, showing no apparent breach or damage. The same went for the castle behind him, dry as a bone, intact, nothing to indicate what he'd just experienced, not a hint of disaster. No dead bodies, not a drop of water. He scratched his head, momentarily wondering if he'd just experienced a new version of his old nightmares. But his drenched clothes told him otherwise. Without further thought, he climbed over the deck railing and up the hillside in the enormous shadow of the castle. The completely dry and undamaged castle. Trudging through the thicket into the trimmed topiary, he hoisted himself up and over a railing into the driveway proper of Byram Castle. The news vans and crews were there, plus a few private cars, including Julia's Audi, which they had arrived in. Nick could barely catch his breath as his heart jumped with fresh hope. "Honey?" The voice came from behind him. Nick spun around to see Julia holding hands with Katie. The moment hung in the air. Nick stared at them as if looking at ghosts. They were alive and smiling, unknowing and unharmed. A mix of anger and bemusement seemed to keep Julia speechless for a moment. Then she asked, "What on earth happened to you?" Without a word, Nick raced to her and kissed her hard on the lips, his hands wrapping her body, pulling her in. She kissed him back, surprised by his sudden affection, but quickly stepped back. "Your jacket, you're soaking wet," she protested. "What were you doing?" Rather than respond, Nick crouched and pulled Katie into his arms, hugging her small body.
"Daddy," she giggled. "Daddy's wet."
Nick leaned back and looked at her face as if for the first time, memorizing every freckle, every crease of her smile, her perfect skin unmarred by time, by life, her eyes filled with innocence and wonder.
"People will be arriving at 5.
Julia held out her wrist, pointing at her Rolex.
"That's less than an hour from now."
Nick took her wrist, looked at the ticking hands of her watch, and smiled.
"You need to go home and change," she said.
"Nope, actually, I need you to leave."
"What?"
Julia squinted at him in confusion, then smiled at his foolishness.
"What are you talking about?"
"I'm serious." Nick looked into her eyes as Julia stared back, trying to understand. Nick scooped Katie up in his arms and hurried toward the Audi.
"Absolutely not," Julia called out from behind him. "This is not funny."
The crowd of reporters turned their way.
"Not trying to be funny," Nick said.
"You're funny, Daddy,"
Katie giggled as Nick opened the rear door and secured her in her car seat.
"The two of you are leaving here right now," he said. "Where's Bonnie?"
"Nick,"
Julia said as she caught up to him.
"Are you insane?"
"Never been saner."
Nick closed Katie's door and turned to his wife.
"Though after what I just went through, most people would be crazy."
"What are you talking about?"
Anger rose in Julia's voice.
"You need to trust me," Nick said. "Bad things are going to happen."
"Bad things?"
The reporters seemed to lean closer at the mention of bad things.
"Stop it!"
Julia raised her voice, trying to cut through the confusion.
"How did you get wet?"
"Do this for me."
Nick stepped back from the car and put his hands gently on Julia's shoulders, holding her at arm's length. He ignored her anger, still unable to shake the desperate look in her eyes that he'd witnessed an hour and 50 minutes in the future. A time that Julia had not yet experienced and could not foresee when she'd slipped from Nick's grasp to her death.
"No,"
she said simply, opening the door to take Katie out of the car.
"Please, Julia, I'm dead serious. Indulge me."
Julia looked into his eyes once more, clearly weighing the day's obligation versus her husband's sudden, erratic behavior. Without a word, she turned and carried Katie back toward Byram Castle, glaring at the nosy reporters as she walked by. An expanse of windows flooded the conference room of Byram Castle with sunlight, providing a view of the valley and sweeping vistas across Westchester County to the skyscraping towers of Manhattan in the far distance. The second-floor meeting room was large, a cherry table surrounded by 14 large leather chairs, its centerpiece. A makeshift stocked bar with a host of crystal glasses was set up in the corner next to an enormous fish tank. Inside the big aquarium, exotic fish swam about without a care for time, dams, or death.
Against the far wall hung an enormous flat-screen TV, a pile of clickers in a basket beneath it. Nick closed the door behind him, reached in his pocket, and pulled out the pocket watch, gold and silver. Its casing's elegant etchings created in an era when craftsmen spent months pursuing perfection. With a shaky thumb, Nick pressed the crown once more, and the cover popped open. He looked at the time. 4:10. Time had never moved so quickly. He dug in the breast pocket of his wet jacket and pulled out his cell, waterlogged and dead. He grabbed the phone in the center of the conference table and dialed. 3 rings, and then voicemail.
"Hello, this is Paul Dreyfus. Please leave a message."
Paul was the one person who would understand what was going on. After all, he was the one who had given Nick the watch and bag before dying in his arms.
"Who the hell are you?" Nick muttered aloud.
He had 50 minutes to stop the world and fix it. 50 minutes to clear the castle and the fields and valleys below before he would be whisked out of this hour. He couldn't believe Paul would have given him Seamus Hennicott's unique pocket watch without any clue or hint about how to stop the looming disaster from happening. Nick removed the bag from his shoulder, laid it upon the table, and unzipped it. Reaching in, he withdrew its contents. The video camera, a large sealed envelope, a cell phone, a BMW smart key, and the smaller second envelope containing the letter from Paul that he had already read. Nick grabbed the video camera, quickly hooked it up to the large screen TV, and hit play. The screen instantly filled with a vision of chaos. A raging sea of large waves filled with flotsam and jetsam swirling about as spray washed against the lens before cutting to. A dark-haired news anchor spoke with a grim face.
"The devastation is enormous. Thousands dead. A warning. The images we are about to show are shocking."
The watery image returned and pulled back to reveal a churning channel of water. A roiling river crashing into a lake. The image pulled back farther, this time slowly panning back and forth, as if the establishing shot in some sort of nature documentary. Quickly, though, it morphed into a horror film. A swath of bodies, hundreds of them, were caught within an eddy formed below a rock outcropping. Men, women, and children in everyday clothes, shorts and skirts, sweats and baseball jerseys. Blankets and picnic baskets floated about, while the tops of cars bobbed as they drifted by.
"A heinous act, no doubt staged for maximum impact, not only to cause countless deaths on Independence Day, but as a direct shot at the U.S. government in the form of Senator Byram Chase,
who at the moment of the dam's breach was giving a speech on the conflict in Akbikwistan. A speech covered by our political correspondent, Marjorie Ross, who was presumed dead along with the rest of the media personnel attending the event. 4th of July celebrations were in full swing in the shadow of the Killian Dam with thousands in attendance, when all were drowned by the sudden and deadly flood. Modest working-class neighborhoods, large estates, and even forests now stand underwater in the southern section of the town of Byram Hills. Horrible images continue to cycle. Bodies broken, dead children afloat. Nick watched footage of the flooded valley, where neighborhoods had sprouted over the last 90 years around Byram Hills, and where nothing now remains. Numerous eyewitnesses reported hearing large explosions just prior to the bursting of the dam. Although yet to be confirmed, the incident is being classified as a terrorist attack.
The country had lived in fear of dirty bombs and weaponized viruses, chemical attacks, and planes falling from the sky. But this had come as a complete surprise. The pent-up power of stored water, more devastating than any ordinary assault. On top of all the death and devastation, an even greater catastrophe loomed. The Killian Reservoir was the main holding body and junction for all of New York City's drinking water. Acting like a way station, the reservoir served as a holding point for water from the 5 upstate New York reservoirs that had supplied fresh water without fail for more than 100 years. 8 million people would turn on their faucets to find nothing but air. Not only showers and drinking water would be affected, but also fire hydrants, whose precious hookups were now rendered dry, and hospitals, now deprived of their most precious resource. The repercussions would ripple through the economy of not only the city, but the country and the world, as the great metropolis transformed into a no-man's land for months, maybe years to come. Suddenly, the video image changed from formal and produced news coverage to haphazard, shaky, and amateur. The footage cut to what was left of the dam. An enormous hole ran up the right side, millions of gallons per minute continuing to pour through in a devastating waterfall, its thunderous roar the only sound coming through the camera's speaker. The camera swung around to reveal the castle that Nick now stood in, its uppermost towers and parapets barely protruding through the roiling waters. As the camera cut back, it focused on a grouping of nearly 100 bodies, all bobbing up and down, some face down, others with dead eyes exposed to the world. As the camera zoomed in, Nick realized he knew many of them. They were the bodies carried out of the castle by the massive current, their lifeless forms caught in a skein of boulders and trees beside the castle. Necks broken, arms twisted at odd angles, skin torn and pierced. The dead included Sharon and Bob Mortimer from down the street, Sabrina and Mitch Fitzgibbons, and young Sarah Bitten, Katie's daycare teacher. Marcus Bennett, Nick's best friend, had not been spared. His body bent at a grotesque angle, his bald head gashed and crushed on the left side. Now the image spun around and focused on the face of a man floating against the rocky shoreline. His blonde hair matted, tinted red with blood, the blue lifeless eyes seeming to stare directly into the camera. There was no mistaking those blue irises. Nick was looking into his own eyes. It was the same image Dreyfus had shown him in the photo before dying. But it was the body next to Nick's that took his breath away, the white linen dress obscenely bright. Julia's body strangely undamaged by the violence that had mutilated so many others. Her face appeared unmarred and peaceful. Her eyes mercifully closed as she floated beside Nick in their watery grave. Nick couldn't bear to see anymore. If he glimpsed Katie's dead image, it would haunt him for all eternity. He pulled the camcorder's cable out of the TV and tucked the camera back in the bag. Paul Dreyfus's point was clear. The footage was like looking through a crystal ball, peering into the future at a disaster of monstrous proportions. And it had clearly been no accident. Much like that nightmarish day 3 years ago, this disaster would begin in the future. In less than 2 hours. Nick clutched the antique pocket watch and said a silent thank you to Seamus Hennicott and Paul Dreyfus. For despite the horror he had witnessed, the disaster had yet to happen. It remained
an event in the future. And the future could be changed.
Detective Bill Shannon stood in the conference room next to Nick. His eyes locked on his friend, questioning his sanity.
How do you know?
You have to trust me, Nick said. You need to not only evacuate this building, but everyone downstream of the dam. There are explosives planted somewhere along the base on the right side. They'll go off at 5:56, killing thousands.
You didn't answer my question.
Shannon stood a little over 6 feet and was in better shape than when he had been a Golden Gloves champion out of the Bronx at age 22. 15 years on the force, 6 as detective, 3 as chief detective, he was a hard ass, though his friends knew that his gruff demeanor was only one side of the man. Shannon had known Nick for more than 3 years now, having met him at the airport during a situation. They had saved each other's lives, a bonding experience neither had mentioned after that day, though their wives had become close friends, forcing dinners and parties at which Nick and Shannon endured their wives retelling the story of crooked cops, stolen artifacts, and mobsters. The conference room door opened and Marcus Bennett stepped in.
Did he tell you this? Shannon asked Marcus. This thing with the dam?
Nick stared at Marcus for a moment, startled, despite himself, to see his friend alive.
I don't know what he told you, Marcus said, but we both know he's not the lying type.
If you're wrong about this, said Shannon, this is going to pull in the feds and a mobilization of emergency personnel like this town has never seen. If you're wrong, losing my job will be the least of my problems.
We have to evacuate. If we don't... He shook his head, unable to describe properly what he'd seen.
Gotta give me something.
Shannon paced nervously as he spoke. Even if you're right, even if they find your so-called explosives, they're going to want to know how you knew. Did you overhear someone? Did someone tell you about it? Do you have any idea who's involved? Nick stared at Shannon, wondering how far to take this.
Give me something to hang my hat on, and I'll call in the world.
Shannon paused.
But friends or not, I can't evacuate a senator, let alone thousands of people, based on a hunch. There's 24-hour security on that dam. No one gets close without being detected.
Nick hooked the camera back up to the television. I'm going to show you something too incredible to explain. He looked straight into Shannon's eyes. What you're about to see will happen in a little more than an hour and a half. Nick hit play. The room fell into silence as the news coverage revealed the disaster, the anchor impassively narrating the details of the terrorist attack. Footage played over her words, overhead shots of the roiling water, the POV of a dead cameraman, the bodies floating away in the current. The debris, which at first looked like tree branches, was revealed to be human remains. It was chaos like nothing Shannon or Marcus had ever seen. And as the footage continued, Nick couldn't look any longer. But he knew that the video's roar of rushing water led to the close-up image of the bodies caught in the culvert. Marcus would now see.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.